Talk about the upcoming elections. I understand that you and many other public officials would prefer not to talk about these things in detail, but there are concerns that you cannot avoid when it comes to issues that are related to the elections. Number one, actually, we've been getting a lot of comments on social media, in particular Twitter, basically asking that one thing. Are you going to run for president in 2022? Others phrase it this way. When will you finally declare your bid for the presidency? Tapos, what would make you run or not run for president in 2022? Vice President Robredo.
Alam mo, Christian, unang-una, nagpapasalamat naman ako sa tiwala sa suporta of people who are appreciative of the work that we've been doing. Pero sa akin, I just want to assure everyone that I don't take this trust lightly. Sa akin naman, I'm giving serious thought on whether or not running will really be the best thing na pwede kong gawin para sa ating bansa. Pero sa akin lang, Christian, I think meron ding parang misunderstanding sa ibang mga supporters na some people I've been receiving a lot of messages on Facebook na mag-desisyon ka na, kailan, parang alam mo yon. Very similar to the messages that you flashed earlier. Pero yung sa akin, Christian, ang daming factors na kinoconsider.
Like what?
Number one is viability. Viability. My numbers are low. So tinitingnan natin yung maraming bagay. Para nga sa akin, Christian, hindi naman ito a matter of personal convenience or not. Kasi para sa akin, kung personal convenience lang, matagal na ako nakapag-desisyon. Pero para kasi sa akin, I think the 2022 elections is a very important election. And tinitingnan ko din yung mga nangyayari, tinitingnan ko yung surveys, tinitingnan ko yung galaw. It's not just me. In fact, I've been talking to small groups of not just supporters, but groups we've been working with for the past 5 years. And kasali sila sa decision-making process. Yung sa akin, hindi siya, it's not simply a matter of gusto ko bang mag-presidente o hindi.
Okay.
Pero ano ba yung makakabuti para sa bayan? Makakabuti ba na ako yung tumakbo? O makakabuti ba na iba yung tumakbo, susuportan na lang ako? Makakabuti ba na magkaisa para sabay-sabay natin na parang to find solutions to the problems that we're currently facing now?
Okay.
So it's not that easy.
Okay.
Not that easy kasi marami talagang considerations.
Well, thank you for the honesty and humility. Pero if I may add to your question, sabi nyo, makakabuti ba yung kung kayong tatakbo o hindi? Eh, siguro isang tanong, makakasama ba pag kayong tumakbo? O mas makakasama ba pag hindi kayo tumakbo for president?
Alam, Christian, ano kasi yun eh? Madali lang sabihin na tatakbo ako o hindi ako tatakbo. Pero ano yung implications? Like, if you look at the numbers, yung last na Pulse Asia survey na lumabas, I was at 6%.
Mm.
So marami kasi parang it's difficult to talk about it in detail. Pero pag tiningnan mo, halimbawa, with my 6%, tatakbo ba ako? Pag kung tumakbo ako, paano niya maapektuhan yung resulta ng eleksyon? Parang ibang usapan, kung tumakbo ako, sigurado ako mananalo. Hindi yun eh. Parang pag tumakbo ako, ano yung epekto nito dun sa, di ba, sa galawan ng entire spectrum of things. So sa akin, tinitingnan ko yun very, very seriously. Ako para sa akin, I would admit, Christian, na hindi ko talaga siya natutukan during the past year or so because we have been so deep into the COVID response initiatives. Pero now we're trying to give it time. Hindi din ako maka-full-time, pero we're trying to give it time. Hindi pa ako okay. Maka-full-time kasi gaya ngayon, sunod yung Vaccine Express. Pero we've been meeting with many different groups already.
Okay.
And yung meeting na to with different groups, it's not like sinasabi ko kung ano mangyayari. Pero tinatanong ko sila na paano kung ganito, paano kung ganyan. So I want to be as consultative and as inclusive as possible when I make the decision. Kasi okay, para sa akin, Christian, hindi naman to itong pag-isip ko sa umaga, gusto ko pala mag-presidente, tatakbo ako. Hindi yun eh. Okay. Kasi there's too much at stake sa 2022 elections.
Okay, definitely. Later on, I'm going to ask you about what is at stake in 2022. But before that, I remember your numbers were also low, if not miserable, in 2016. But you pulled it off. Of course, this is an entirely different campaign. This is a presidential race or the presidential election. Honestly, are you convinced with what the survey results are telling you? Because others are doubting the results. Are you convinced and are you disheartened by your current numbers?
Ako, Christian, we look at survey results very seriously. Para sa akin, ano naman to eh, there's a lot of science behind it. And in the past elections, the survey numbers have been very close to what the election results have been. So para sa akin, Christian, there have been a lot of, alam mo yon, actually when we present the results to the groups that we have been meeting, yung iba hindi makapaniwala. Pero sa akin kasi, Christian, sa akin, I want to be very, very deliberate about it. 2016 is so different from the situation today. Kasi in 2016, I was running for vice president. I was relatively unknown. Ang gusto kong sabihin, my awareness ratings were down. So there was a lot of elbow room for me to improve my numbers. Gusto kong sabihin, I started at 1%. Mm. I think by the time I filed, I'm not too sure about the figures now, but I think by the time I filed in October of 2015, I was at 2%. Mm. Pero even during that time, we have been seriously looking at the numbers. And noon kasi, Christian, iba yung sitwasyon.
Okay.
Iba yung sitwasyon. I was an admin candidate. So the infrastructure was there. And because I was not running for president, parang hindi ko pre-problema yung resources because the party was there. And you know, the state of okay, our party now, wala naman akong resources to launch a decent presidential campaign. So para sa akin, before I make that decision, gusto ko handa ako. Handa ako, hindi lang tingin ko sa trabaho, matagal na akong handa at matagal na naghahanda. Pero yung kampanya mismo, Christian, it will be difficult. It will be difficult given the current political landscape.
Okay. But do you honestly have a choice not to run for president? Given your standing, your position as the top opposition elective official who is with the opposition. I mean, to be honest about it, to be blunt about it, do you really have a choice? Kung hindi kayo, sinong tatakbo?
Oo naman. Matagal na natin pinaglalaban na dapat lahat tayo parating may choice. I think ano naman 'yon. Para lang sa akin, Christian, importante lang maging honest. Importante maging honest halimbawa sa supporters namin na umaasa. And yung honesty na 'yon, makakabuti kung kasama sila sa proseso. Kasama sila sa proseso, not just the discernment process but the decision making process itself. And that's what we're doing now. We're trying to talk to as many supporters as possible, to as many like-minded people as possible. Mahirap lang ngayon kasi we can't do big meetings and yun nga, we're in the middle of our COVID response operations, but we're trying to.
Okay.
We've been working really hard, consulting as many groups as we can, showing them the data that we have. We want the decision making process to be really consultative. Kasi mahirap din, Christian, na yung padalos-dalos. Sabihin mo, go, magkakandidato ako, tapos nagkawatak-watak lahat. Para kasi sa akin, Christian, parang we can't last another, I've said it already before, parang we can't last another 6 years of this kind of governance. Para sa akin, lalo na nasa gitna tayo ng pandemic. We've lost so much already. Para sa akin, things should change. And bahagi siya ng decision-making process.
Okay.
Na,
actually, that was
madali lang sa
Actually,
Sige.
That was supposed to be my next question because I often hear that, especially from the opposition groups, coming from your supporters. Parang can this country afford another 6 years of Duterte? I mean, we're not talking of President Duterte again being president, but his daughter. You already answered that, diba? In the form of a question. Can this country afford another 6 years of the same kind of governance? Which brought me back to my original question to you. I mean, you have a lot at stake and you have a lot of responsibilities with you, definitely. So I'd like to ask a very specific question. Okay, so we understand the reality check that you've been putting on yourself and on your supporters. That's fine, okay? So siguro yung mga ibang nanonood sa atin, ang tingin doon sa mga sinabi nyo, well, hindi ito nagpapakipot or playing coy, just like other politicians na kunwari reluctant, pero yung talaga kilig na kilig, gusto tumakbo. Anyway, we leave that decision to the viewers. In the meantime, may mga klarong galaw coming from the administration, and I'd like to get your honest opinion about these actions. Number one, Sara Duterte, the daughter of President Duterte, open to running for president, and most likely, she would be gunning for the presidency because the opportunity is there. And President Duterte, just recently, saying that he was open to running for vice president kasi raw, he wanted to enjoy the immunity. I mean, what do you think of this? The possibility of that political dynasty that was established in Davao City being elevated to the very top in Malacanang, possibly in 2022?
Christian, I just wish that, that whatever decision she ultimately makes, she will always bear in mind our country's welfare. Kanya-kanya naman yung decision, Christian, na hindi naman natin pwedeng pakialaman. Kanya-kanya yung aming pinanggagalingan. Sabi ko nga, deciding on my own situation is hard enough. Ayoko nang pakialaman yung proseso naman ng decision making ng iba. Pero yung wish ko lang, Christian, na sana laging best interest of the country. Kung kailangan namin isakripisyo yung sarili namin na hindi kami yung tatakbo, iba yung tatakbo, basta ang punot dulo nun, ano ba yung makakabuti sa bansa natin? So sa akin, I always ask that question. Kaya decision, parang making a decision is hard. Kasi hindi mo, parang alam mo yun, there are many factors that are put into play. When you decide something na ganito kahirap. Yung second question mo, Christian, about the president running for the vice presidency, I was asked about it by media earlier today doon sa CCP complex. Umuulan pa naman ng malakas. Tinatanong ako about how I felt about the president's statements that he's running for the vice presidency. Ang sabi ko lang sa kanila, and I really mean it, na kung tatakbo siya at mananalo siya, sana wag niyang maranasan ang naranasan ko bilang vice president. Because para sa akin, again, ang daming missed opportunities na kung binigyan lang ng pagkakataon na makatrabaho kami ng na buwelo, mas marami pa sana kami nagawa. Okay. So sa akin, kanya-kanya naman yung kresa na proseso .
Okay, may related question doon sa sinabi nyo. So sabi nyo, sana kung manalo man siyang vice president, hindi nyo maranasan yung nararanasan nyo ngayon. Hypothetical naman ang discussion, so there's a related question on Twitter for you regarding that. So, assuming that you win the presidency in 2022 and the president wins the vice presidency, would you treat him the way he has been treating you now? Or would you give him a cabinet position, make him more relevant than compared to how he has tried to make you irrelevant under his administration?
Parang poetic justice pag nangyari, Christian. pero sa akin, very, very seriously, ako, I will not treat him the way he treated me. Kasi I don't think it is to the best interest of the people na yung presidente saka vice president, tag-aaway. Pero having said that, atatanong ko siya kung, kasi narinig ko din, Christian, sa speech niya, na kung manalo siya, matutulog na lang siya at maghihintay siya. Mamatay, hindi ko alam kung mamatay ang presidente o whatever. So syempre tatanungin mo, it's not as simple as giving him a cabinet post, pero tatanungin mo anong trabaho yung palagay niya he will be good at, kung he will be committed to the work that will be given to him. Pero if he will, pag nagsabi siya he will be committed to the work that will be given to him, I think it's for the best na yung vice president is given a cabinet post.
Okay. Pero hindi ba karapal yung another Duterte gunning for the presidency?
As you have said earlier, Christian, they have done that in Davao already. Ako, alam mo naman where I stand, even when I was in Congress, in fact, I was co-author of the anti-dynasty law. Ang paniniwala ko naman kasi walang iisang pamilyang may monopoly sa good intentions. Eh. Walang iisang pamilya na may monopoly ng kahusayan. So yung sa akin, there are a lot of very good people who can actually contribute very well to nation building na wala sigurong apelyido na kilala, na walang pedigree na. Yun yung dahilan kung bakit tingin ko dapat binibigyan ng pagkakataon ng mas maraming tao. Pero okay. Yun sa akin yun, Christian.
Okay. Again, this is in the realm of possibilities. Again, hypothetically. Maraming nagtatanong kasi, if you read the Twitter comments related to this ongoing interview, lahat sila nagtatanong, kailan ba kayo magde-decide? Tatakbo ba kayo o hindi? Iba naman ang tanong nila, pag, not kung, manalo kayo. Again, I think these are your supporters asking. But might as well ask their questions in this interview. One question is, if you win the presidency, what would you do regarding the China policy that the Duterte administration has been implementing? Siguro, gawin natin specific, no? What would you do with the issue of the arbitral victory that was set aside by the president in 2016? And number two, the friendly approach with China in exchange for projects which are still wanting in terms of completion, if not the start of implementation. Your response to that, ma'am?
Well, ako, Christian, I have responded to that several times already. Pero yung iba, not in the context of if I was the president. Yung sa akin, I have been very vocal about my feelings on how we are not using to our advantage the ruling by the arbitral tribunal. Sa akin kasi, Christian, it was a very big win. It was a very big win and it was a very big opportunity for the Philippines to, you know, to solicit multilateral partnerships with the other Southeast Asian countries. Na yung interest sa West Philippine Sea similar to ours. So para sa akin, I have been very vocal about it. Na dapat matagal na natin itong ginawa after we won July of 2016. We should have used that to our advantage already. By the way we treat the further incursions. Ito yung pakiramdam ko about the West Philippine Sea. Yung pangalawa, pag tinignan kasi natin, Christian, halimbawa itong being friendly with China, ako I am all for it. Nakita natin halimbawa how Vietnam has been positioning itself pagdating sa kanyang relationship with China. Meron silang hindi pagkakaintindihan as far as the West Philippine Sea is concerned, pero yung kanilang economic relations continue, yung kanilang diplomatic relations continue. Pero sa akin, pag tinignan natin, ano ba yung naging benefit ng pivot natin to China? Okay. Yung sa akin, tingnan natin, did it result to increased FDI from China? How did we benefit economically from the pivot? Parang it should be data-driven. Kasi madali lang sabihin ayoko sa US, gusto ko sa China, o ayoko sa China, gusto ko sa US. Pero mas mabuti pag-aralan ano ba yung mga benefits na na-derive natin. Halimbawa, I was reading at parang an assessment na one of the reasons why naging dismal yung FDI natin over the last few years is ano talaga yung treatment yung relationship na na-cultivate ng administration na to with the West. Okay. Yung US, yung Europe, many other countries.
Okay.
Ang tanong, did it benefit us? In the same way that yung pivot ba natin sa China? Halimbawa, you were hoping that you would get the same amount of, at least similar to what Indonesia has been getting as far as ODA is concerned. We didn't. So yung sa akin, it should be a data-driven decision. Pag-aralan natin what was our experience the last 5 years.
Okay.
It should matter. Sige, Christian.
Another hypothetical question. Marami nagre-request itong tanong na to. If you win the presidency, what would be your priorities within the first 100 days? Siguro, dagdag ko na rin, what are you going to do with the bloody drug war of the president?
Ako, if you recall, Christian, I already submitted, I think 2019, when I was taken out of ICAD, I already submitted all my recommendations as far as the drug, the conduct of the drug war is concerned. It's in the ICAD report. It's really very specific. I can spend another hour just talking about it. Pero I know what to do because I've seen enough in my 18 days in ICAD. So that's one. Pero yung susunod kasi, Christian, na presidente, pandemic pa eh. Gusto ko sabihin, yung remnants o yung effects na pandemic will still be in our midst. So dapat yung una talaga mga gagawin kung paano mag-respond doon. Paano mag-respond not just as far as yung virus or the transmission is concerned, pero many other things like yung health capacity, yung education na nag-suffer ng napakalaki because of the pandemic, yung economy natin na is performing very dismally now. How are we going to turn around things? Yung pang-apat, anong gagawin natin sa loss of jobs and livelihood? Ang panlima, ano yung gagawin natin? Kasi alam mo, lahat na economic indicators natin ngayon bagsak. In fact, there have been a lot of think tanks that are predicting that the Philippines will be the last na magre-recover out of this. Okay. So I would presume after June 30 of 2022, now that will still be the most important problems that we have to face.
Okay, earlier
you
mentioned...
So all the things that we will do...
Okay, sorry for cutting you off. Earlier you said that one of the biggest issues that you're confronting right now is viability. And of course, number two is resources. But in terms of competence, given the issues that you laid down, especially the pandemic response, do you have the competence to deal with those issues if you decide to run and actually win the presidency?
Alam mo, Christian, hindi lang competence ng tumatakbong presidente, pero competence din ng buong team na dadalhin niya into office. Yung para sa akin, as I've said, wala naman tayong monopoly ng husay. Wala tayong monopoly ng good intentions, pero mahalaga anong klaseng mga civil servants o public servants ang makakasama natin sa team natin. Kasi yung governance naman, hindi lang isang tao yun eh. Yung governance, it's the entire team. And it's also your ability to inspire people. It's your ability to inspire people to take part, an active part in governance. Ako, Christian, I've been a very strong advocate of people participation. I've been a very strong advocate of hindi ako yung trickle down. Ako parati akong from the ground up. In fact, when I was in Congress, most of the bills that I have filed are always geared towards that type of governance. And I think it's what the country needs. My late husband was also a very big advocate of that.
Okay.
Sa akin yun eh.
I'm sorry we don't have much time anymore, but I'd like to squeeze in two important questions. Number one, if you become president, will you cooperate with the ICC in its investigation of the crimes against humanity information so far, or perhaps later on case that was filed against President Duterte? And number two, tuhugin ko na po para dire-direcho. There was a comment from one of our viewers, sabi niya, if you say we cannot afford another regime such as the current one, would you not feel a sense of dereliction given your special place in the scheme of things if you did not run?
I will answer the first question first, Christian. Ako, I do not want to discuss it in the context of the case against the president. Ako, parang ako, I want to be very... I want the decision on the ICC to be more comprehensive in the sense na bakit ba tayo nag-member ng ICC in the first place? Ano yung dahilan natin kung bakit tayo nag-member ng ICC in the first place? Ano yung naging dahilan natin kung bakit tayo umalis sa ICC? Kasi I think it will be very important for us parang to commit ourselves na kung kinakailangan natin maging miyembro talaga ng ICC, kailangan maging committed tayo sa lahat na proseso niya. Yun para sa akin. Para kasi sa akin, masyadong political, tapos lumabas pa na parang vendetta na sasabihin ko na I will be very supportive of the ICC kasi gusto kong ipakuli o ipakulong si Presidente. I don't think that's the right way of deciding on the fate of our membership in the ICC. So okay, Pag-aralan bakit ba tayo nag in the first place, would that be advantageous to the country moving forward? Yun yung one.
Okay.
Yung number two, Christian, ako aware ako ng mga sinasabi na may mga nagsasabi pa nga sa akin, Christian, na makakatulog ka pa ba sa gabi pag humindi ka na hindi ka kandidato? And sa akin, Christian, I want to explain na part of the decision-making process is really looking at the numbers. Halimbawa, ito mas hypothetical pero it's based on the current numbers that we have. 6% ako ngayon. Pag tumakbo ba ako ng 6%, sabihin na natin na kasi halimbawa, we just want to make a statement run. Diba? 6%. Yung 6% ko ba, nakatulong ba yon sa cost natin? O baka nakatulong pa ako na another 6 years of this kind of governance? That's part of the decision-making process. So halimbawa, kung tumakbo pa din ako despite my numbers, sino yung magbe-benefit nun?
Okay.
Parang walang problema kung despite na 6% ako ngayon, sigurado ako mananalo. Pero halimbawa, hindi ako mananalo at hindi na dumagdag yung akin numbers, sino yung magbe-benefit ng pagtakbo ko? So yun sa akin, Christian, it's not easy. It's not easy kasi marami tayong mga unknowns pa, di ba? So we're working on what we have now. And it's the reason why the decision-making process is difficult is marami pa talagang mga blanco.
Okay.
Marami pa mga blanco, but ako, I'm being very honest about it, na we're looking at those.
Okay.
Madali lang sabihin na tumakbo no matter what, pero sino magbe-benefit?
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Vice President Lenny Robredo, for answering our questions and for joining us this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you.